Hello and welcome to the next module in the Waters Peptide and Protein Bioanalysis Bootcamp. My name is Khalid Khan and I'm part of the Health Sciences Marketing Team here at Waters. And today I will be presenting on peptide and protein structure, so let's get started. Here are a number of workflows for large molecule biotherapeutic and protein biomarker analysis. Today, LC-MS is increasingly used for protein quantification as an alternative to the traditional ligand binding assays. Proteins can be analyzed by LC-MS either using intact protein or surrogate peptide workflows. Both tandem quadrupole and high-resolution mass spectrometers can be used. Normal flow and microflow LC systems are also commonly used with both of these mass spectrometer systems. Most of this module will focus on the surrogate peptide workflow using tandem mass spectrometers. An understanding of peptides and protein structure is important when developing both intact and surrogate peptide workflows. The areas covered in this presentation will be the basic structure of amino acids, peptides, and proteins, including a few specific examples such as monoclonal antibodies. The basic structure of peptides and proteins has an impact on both the sample treatment and LC-MS method development. The ionization and fragmentation of peptides and how these aspects differ from small molecules will also be covered. The presentation is mainly intended for scientists who already have some experience in small molecule LC-MS method development. The aim is to provide an introduction to peptide and protein structure and explain the commonly used terms in peptide and protein LC-MS method development. The presentation will also prepare you for subsequent modules in the Waters Peptide and Protein Bioanalysis Bootcamp. In this first section, let's look at the structure of peptides and proteins. Peptides and proteins are chains of amino acids joined together. There is no agreed criteria that specifies the length of an amino acid chain that defines whether it is called a peptide or a protein. One common definition is that if the amino acid chain consists of less than 50 amino acids, it is called a peptide, and more than 50 amino acids, it is called a protein. This definition is not absolute, and you can have large peptides and small proteins of similar amino acid chain lengths. All human proteins are formed from just 20 naturally occurring amino acids, or 21 if you include selenocysteine. In terms of molecular weight, peptides are typically less than 6,000 daltons, whereas proteins can be anywhere from 5,800 daltons for a small protein such as insulin, or several hundred thousand daltons for a large protein such as thyroglobulin. This slide illustrates the mechanism of how two amino acids join together to form a peptide bond. The carboxylic group of one amino acid reacts with the amine group of another amino acid to form a peptide bond. The resultant peptide will have a carboxylic group at one end, and this is referred to as the C-terminal end. The amine group is referred to as the N-terminal end. As we will see later, these peptide bonds fragment in a highly predictable manner in a mass spectrometer collision cell. Amino acids and peptides can exist as Ritter ions. This means that they can have both negative and positive charges depending on the pH. This is an important factor when developing sample cleanup methods at the peptide level. This will be discussed in more detail in later modules. The chain of amino acids that form the backbone of a peptide or protein is referred to as its primary structure. Amino acids are usually represented by a single letter or three-letter abbreviation. Here is a table of the 21 amino acids from which human peptides and proteins are formed. Some single letters are obvious, for example, G for glycine and A for alanine. Others are less obvious, such as K for lysine and R for arginine. As we will see later in this presentation, lysine and arginine are very important when we discuss the breakdown of large proteins into smaller peptides using specific enzyme digestion. This slide illustrates the wide variety of structures and resultant chemical properties of amino acids. The chemical structure of the amino acids influences the polarity, hydrophobicity, and acidic basic nature of the resultant peptides and proteins. Note that cysteine contains a sulfur atom, which means that two cysteine amino acids can form disulfide bonds between them. These disulfide bonds can form in the same peptide chain or connect two different peptide chains. As stated earlier, the diverse properties of peptides and proteins have a large impact on the sample pretreatment and LC-MS method development. Note that some amino acids have a second amine group, which means that they have multiple sites that can be protonated to form multiply charged positive ions. As the structures of all amino acids are well known, it is possible to calculate the mass of a peptide from its amino acid constituents. Don't worry, you will not have to calculate these manually. Software tools are available to do this automatically for you. Software tools such as Skyline will automatically calculate the molecular weight of a peptide from its amino acid sequence. For example, the peptide DEBIL, which consists of aspartic acid, glutamic acid, valine, isoleucine, and leucine, will have a mass of 587.31662 Daltons. Note that the table above lists the monoisotopic mass and average mass. The monoisotopic mass is the mass when only the most abundant isotopes are used in the calculation, i.e. carbon-12, hydrogen-1, oxygen-16. The average mass is when all the minor isotopes are also included in the calculation, i.e. carbon-13, deuterium, and nitrogen-15. Proteins can exist in different forms and structures. So far, we have only discussed the basic amino acid sequence, which is referred to as a primary structure. Amino acids can form hydrogen bond interactions between each other, which influences the shape of a peptide chain or protein. The most common structures are a pleated sheet and alpha helix. Bonds and interactions between alpha helices and pleated sheets result in tertiary structures. Sulfur bonds between cysteine amino acids in a peptide chain are common in tertiary structures. Finally, when more than one different type of peptide chain is involved, quaternary structure is produced. This slide illustrates the primary structure of insulin, which includes two amino acid chains joined together, the insulin A chain and the insulin B chain. The slide also shows a diagram of the tertiary structure of insulin. Here is an example of a peptide drug, desmopressin. This is a relatively small peptide comprised of 9 amino acids. The LCMS development of a peptide of this length can be treated in the same way as a small molecule LCMS method. The peptide can be analyzed directly by LCMS, and standards are available for MRM method development. One difference from a small molecule electrospray mass spectrum is the presence of a doubly charged positive ion in addition to the singly charged ion. This is a key feature of peptide ionization that will be discussed later in this presentation and other modules. Note the doubly charged ion at 535.22 and the singly charged ion at 106.9435. An example of a small protein is insulin, which consists of 51 amino acids. The A chain has 21 amino acids and the B chain has 30 amino acids. The monoisotopic mass of insulin is 5803.6377, which is outside the range of tandem quadrupole mass spectrometer systems, which typically have a maximum upper range of below 2000 Daltons. However, as insulin forms multiply charged ions with 3, 4, and 5 charges, it can be analyzed using tandem mass spectrometers. In this example, the 5 plus ion is shown at mass 1162. Insulin also forms 3 plus and 4 plus ions. Note again the disulfide bonds connecting the two amino acid chains between two cysteine amino acids. These are very common in protein structures. Here are some examples of larger proteins ranging from insulin-like growth factor IGF-1 with a molecular weight of 7649 to thyroglobulin, which has a molecular weight of over 660,000 Daltons. The slide also shows medium-sized proteins such as CRP and apolipoprotein A1, which have molecular weights in the mid-20,000 Dalton range. We can see that as the size of the proteins increase, the challenge of measuring the intact protein gets more difficult and is virtually impossible using limited range tandem mass spectrometers. However, we can break down large proteins into smaller peptide units and analyze these peptides using tandem mass spectrometers. This approach is called the surrogate peptide approach and is widely used in protein bioanalysis and protein biomarker research. Antibodies are a specific class of proteins with a common structure. They are large Y-shaped proteins with two heavy chains and two light chains. The heavy chains are linked to each other via disulfide bonds. Sulfur bonds also link the light chains with the heavy chains. Human immunoglobulin is an antibody produced by plasma cells to fight infections. The heavy chain contains approximately 440 amino acids, and the light chains contain 220 amino acids. Monoclonal antibody drugs now form a very important class of therapeutics and need to be measured in biological studies and clinical research studies. One of the most widely used monoclonal antibody drugs today is infliximab, which is used to treat autoimmune conditions such as Crohn's disease. Infliximab binds to TNF-alpha and has a molecular weight of approximately 150,000 Daltons. Infliximab is known as a chimeric antibody. Infliximab binds to TNF-alpha, and infliximab is a chimeric antibody. So how do we analyze large proteins of several thousand Daltons using tandem quadrupole mass spectrometers, which usually have a limited mass range of less than 2,000 Daltons? The approach used is to break down the proteins into smaller peptides using digestion with enzymes. A number of different enzymes are used. The most commonly used enzyme is trypsin, which cleaves proteins in very specific locations. Trypsin cleaves proteins adjacent to lysine and arginine. Cleavage is always on the C-terminus side of the amino acid. This means that peptides arising from trypsin digestion, which are called tryptic peptides, can be predicted from the amino acid sequence of the protein. Online software tools are available to predict tryptic peptides. And these online tools also predict the fragmentation of those peptides in a mass spectrometer. This is the basis of the surrogate peptide approach, where a peptide or peptides are quantified as a surrogate for the protein from which the peptides were derived from. In some cases, proteins cannot be digested directly by enzymes such as trypsin and require pretreatment prior to digestion. One example of this is treatment of disulfide bonds, which are reduced and alkylated prior to digestion. If the amino acid sequence of the tryptic peptide is unique to the protein from which it was derived from, it is called the signature peptide. The use of signature peptides means that the method is more selective and specific. Tryptic peptides should contain between 8 and 20 amino acids. In addition, tryptic peptides should not contain amino acids that can be easily chemically modified, such as cysteine and methionine. The selection of tryptic peptides will be discussed in more detail in other modules in this series. Now that we've covered the basic structure of peptides and proteins, and we've discussed how peptides can be produced from proteins using enzyme digestion, let's look at how peptides fragment in a mass spectrometer. This slide highlights some of the differences between LCMS of small molecules and LCMS of proteins and peptides. One difference, which has already been discussed in earlier slides, is that peptides form multiply charged ions. Doubly, triply, and even high charge peptide ions are very common. This is very different to small molecule LCMS, where usually the precursor ion is singly charged. Peptide fragments generated in a mass spectrometer collision cell will have fewer charges than the precursor ions. This means that peptide fragments that have fewer charges will appear at a higher mass to charge ratio than the precursor ions. This is very different to what you would see in small molecule fragmentation, where the product ion is always at a lower mass to charge ratio than the precursor ion. Also, as we've seen before, peptides fragment in a highly predictable manner along the amino acid chain. Peptides can fragment at a number of predictable locations in the peptide chain. The nomenclature of the resultant fragment ions depend on which bond has been broken. When fragmentation occurs at the peptide bond, the C-terminal fragment is called the Y-ion and the N-terminal fragment is called the B-ion. Y and B-ions are the most important for quantification using mass spectrometry. For tryptic peptides, the Y-ion will always have a lysine or arginine amino acid at C-terminal end. Fragmentation can also occur adjacent to the peptide bond, leading to other ions, which are called Z, C, A, and X ions. As we've already discussed, peptides can produce a number of predictable fragment ions. The selections of which ion to use in an MRM experiment needs to be carefully considered. In this example, fragmentation of the ion at 523.2808 results in a number of fragment ions shown in the lower half of the slide. Which ones would be the best to use in an MRM method? There are a number of potential fragment ions we could use. There's the most intense ion at 239 and other ions at 341, 523, 873, 1045. Let's evaluate these ions now. The ion shaded in red, although intense, may not be a good choice as these are all low masses and could be prone to interference from other peptides. The ion at 1045 is the singly charged ion from 5232, so would not be utilized. The Y ions shown in the green shaded area at 873, 944, 802, and 674 are all potentially usable as they are of sufficient intensity and size. This slide again highlights another feature of peptide fragmentation in the mass spectrometer, which is doubly charged ions fragmented to singly charged ions and therefore resulting in the product ion at a higher mass to charge ratio than the precursor ion mass. So we may not have access to standards of all the potential triptych peptides we want to develop MRM methods for. However, there are software tools such as Skyline which can predict fragmentation of triptych peptides. Tools such as Skyline predict and suggest fragment ions that can be used in LCMS method development. These ions can be evaluated later by experiment. This is very important as it means that you do not need to have access to standards of the triptych peptide for initial method development. So let's summarize what we've learned about peptide ionization and fragmentation. Peptide form multiply charged ions, which is very different to traditional small molecule analysis. Peptides fragment in a highly predictable manner in the mass spectrometer, and these fragments can be predicted using software tools. These software tools will also recommend which MRM transitions to use. The resultant fragment ions, which are often Y ions, have a higher mass to charge than precursor mass to charge. The MRM transitions that are finally used are selected based on specificity and intensity of the fragment ions. So let's summarize some of the key points of this introduction to peptides and protein structure. Peptides and proteins are made of amino acids and can form a variety of complex structures. Small proteins and peptides can be analyzed directly, i.e. intact by tandem quadrupole LCMS systems. Larger proteins usually require digestion to smaller peptides for quantification by tandem quadrupole LCMS systems. Enzymatic cleavage sites are predictable and software tools available that can predict triptych peptides. The structure of peptides and proteins impacts all stages of the bioanalysis workflow. This slide shows the workflow for the surrogate workflow approach, where a protein is enzymatically digested by trypsin to produce signature or unique peptides. The process starts with selecting the unique peptides, which represent the protein we are trying to measure. These unique peptides are predicted by software tools. The best MR transitions are then selected and optimized. We then go through the process of optimizing sample preparation, which may involve cleanup at the protein level, reduction, alkylation, digestion, and peptide level cleanup. The MRM transitions may then need to be fine-tuned using peptides generated in the biological matrix. The structure of peptides and protein is an important factor and needs to be considered in all of the above steps. This presentation was designed to introduce peptide and protein structure and how the structure of peptide and protein influences LCMS method development. Further information is available on a variety of web-based resources, including these. Thank you for listening.